Hi everybody. In this video, we'll be continuing our discussion of the history and motivation of quantum mechanics, this time talking more about the dual nature of matter rather than light. First, I'd like to just remind us of where we left off last time. In the previous video, we talked about the fact that the reality of light is very strange. Depending on what you're measuring, it can sometimes behave as waves with a wavelength and frequency that are measurable, and it can sometimes behave as a beam of particles. These two equations sum up where we left off last time, where the equation C equals lambda nu tells us the relationship between the wavelength and frequency of light, and the second equation, E equals h nu, tells us that the energy of a photon, of the smallest packet of light, is proportional to the frequency of the light. In the previous video, we talked about two observations, blackbody radiation and the photoelectric effect, that illustrated that something was incomplete about classical mechanics. To start this video, I want to talk about a third observation. But first, we need to talk a bit about how scientists viewed atoms in the late 1800s. At the time that quantum mechanics was developed, scientists more or less accepted Rutherford's model of the atom. You may remember from general chemistry that Rutherford showed in the gold foil experiment that an atom has a very dense, very small nucleus that's positively charged, which is surrounded by negatively charged electrons. So scientists saw atoms basically as tiny solar systems with a very small, positively charged nucleus, and then an electron orbiting the nucleus at a fixed radius, the way that a planet does. So the expectation, based on Rutherford's model of the atom, is that an electron could absorb or emit any amount of energy. But it turns out that that's not true. When you heat up a tube of hydrogen gas or of the gas of any element, specific colors come out of it. You may have seen this demonstration before, where every element has sort of a characteristic fingerprint, a series of bands of different colors that are emitted when an electron drops from a higher energy to a lower energy. These atomic spectra were first rationalized by Niels Bohr. Remember that Planck said that the energy levels of a black body are quantized, and Einstein said that the energy of light is quantized. Bohr took this a step further and said that the energy levels of electrons are quantized. So while electrons are still basically orbiting the nucleus, Bohr said that to explain these atomic spectra, we have to say that the electrons can only have certain orbits. This picture shows us an electron in a hydrogen atom that can only have certain orbits corresponding to n equals 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. We'll call n the principal quantum number, and we'll see plenty more of it as we get further into quantum mechanics. But for now, just be aware that in order to explain these atomic spectra, the electron can only have certain energy levels, only certain orbits, and each spectral line corresponds to the energy that's released when an electron drops down from a higher energy level to a lower energy level. For example, when an electron drops from n equals 3 to n equals 2, the excess energy that it loses is released as light. For the hydrogen atom, there's actually a pretty simple experimental relationship between the different energy levels. Each energy level corresponding to a value of n is equal to negative some constant, which is called the Rydberg constant, over n squared, which means the difference between two energy levels, the energy of the photons that are released when an electron drops down in energy, is expressed by the bottom equation. Rydberg constant times the difference between 1 over n for the initial energy level and 1 over n for the final energy level. To see all of the different bands that appear in the hydrogen spectrum, you can plug in all different positive integers for n1 and n2. The textbook has kind of a sketchy derivation of this for a hydrogen atom, and we'll actually look deeper into this for the multiproton case in class. So the Bohr model of the atom does a reasonable job rationalizing emission spectra, but still something feels like it's not quite right. In the Bohr model, electrons are still basically particles orbiting the nucleus. So the idea that electrons can only be in specific orbits and somehow get from one orbit to the other without occupying the space between is kind of strange. Also, and this isn't very important for you to understand, there was a classical prediction at the time that if electrons were particles orbiting the nucleus, they would radiate light and in a very short time spiral into the nucleus, There's a big German word associated with this, Bremsstrahlung, which translates to something like breaking radiation. So in any case, this was another sign that something wasn't quite right about the idea that electrons were just particles orbiting the nucleus. And maybe the clearest visual example that something is wrong is that electrons can be diffracted. In the same way that when you shine a beam of light through a grating, you see bright spots and dark spots, you see an interference pattern. The same thing happens when you shine a beam of electrons through a crystal. You see regions of high intensity and regions of low intensity, like the picture on this slide. And that is not something that you would expect if electrons were just objects orbiting the nucleus. In fact, by analogy with light, you might see that this kind of suggests that electrons are somehow behaving as waves. It was Louis de Broglie who then had a really radical idea. De Broglie said that if light, which we traditionally think of as waves, can sometimes behave as a beam of particles, why can't matter, which we traditionally think of as particles, have some wave-like character? To quantify this, de Broglie used an idea that was known from wave mechanics at the time, the fact that a photon's momentum, p, is equal to Planck's constant over the wavelength, to say that, well, what if the momentum of an object, mv, the mass times the velocity, which was known from Newtonian mechanics, is equal to the same thing, Planck's constant over the wavelength. And a small rearrangement of this equation gives us what's now called the de Broglie relation. Lambda, the wavelength, is equal to Planck's constant h over classical momentum, mass times velocity. So the very strange thing about this equation that I want to emphasize is that this equation is telling us the wavelength of an object, the wavelength of matter, not the wavelength of a light wave or something like that. So this implies that all of the objects around us have a wavelength. And this is very strange. The implication is that objects are inherently fuzzy, that you can't know exactly where an object is. I do want to point out that all of these ideas have to be consistent with everything we know about the world around us. So if you think about a macroscopic object, something like a car, that has a relatively large classical momentum, a large product of mass and velocity. Because mv is in the denominator, something that has a large momentum is going to have an unmeasurably small wavelength. So for something like a car, we don't really have to worry about its wave-like character. But in quantum mechanics, we're not thinking about cars, we're thinking about electrons, and electrons are really small. So for electrons, which have very, very small momenta, their wavelength, the uncertainty in where they are, is comparable to the size of an atom. So for electrons, the idea of a particle-wave duality of matter becomes really important. Now that we've gone through all this historical context, we can think about what all of this means. We've seen that objects are inherently wave-like. In other words, we can't unambiguously talk about where any object is located. So the implication of that is that classical mechanics, Newtonian mechanics, is not complete, and we need a radically different way of thinking about things. I should emphasize that Newtonian mechanics isn't wrong. It works really well for macroscopic objects. But we've seen that for small objects, like electrons, there's a more complete set of rules that often doesn't look like Newtonian mechanics. So while this new set of rules has to look like Newtonian mechanics at the macroscopic scale, it's going to look very different at the submicroscopic scale. And we'll really be spending the rest of this course learning about this new set of rules, learning about quantum mechanics. The scientist who was most important in developing quantum mechanics, who we'll hear more about next time, was Erwin Schrödinger. In 1926, Schrödinger published the equation that governs quantum mechanics, which is now called the Schrödinger equation, and showed that it worked to explain the energies of hydrogen electrons, the energies that we saw in the Rydberg equation previously. And like the other scientists that we've talked about, Schrödinger won the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1933. So that sets the stage, and in future videos, we'll be talking about how quantum mechanics actually works.